I wanted to build a large shed at the bottom of my garden to replace an old shed and act as a workshop. So I did a scale drawing of the garden and spent some time thinking about how large I could make the workshop without compromising too much of my garden. So I got rid of the shed and decided that 4 meters by 2.7 meters with a height of 2.2 meters should be a good size. There was lots of digging to be done. I had to take about 2.5 meters off the length of my lawn to clear enough space for the workshop. I'd already built a smaller shed at the top of my garden for storage, just to hold lawnmowers, bikes, that sort of thing. And you can find more details about that on my blog. I found somebody locally who was selling lots of wood that had been salvaged from an old warehouse. I bought 8 sheets of 3/4 inch plywood, which I thought would be good for the floor, and 53 by 2 timbers that I could use to build the frame. The downside of using this salvage wood was that it was full of old nails and it took quite a bit of time to pull them all out. I also found these 2 aluminium caravan windows for sale locally, so at this point I had some materials and it was time to design a frame. I used SketchUp for this. I made the frame 2.2 metres high at the front and 2.1 metres high at the back so that the roof would be at an angle and the rain would fall off the back. The frame was designed as 8 separate panels with most of the uprights spaced 600 millimetres apart. I used half lap joints for the frame to add strength and also to make assembly a little bit easier. I didn't design a roof or a door at this point, mainly because I didn't know what materials I would come across to build them. Once all of the digging was complete, I had to build a new retaining wall at the edge of the lawn. My bricklaying skills leave a lot to be desired, but as it was only 3 courses of blocks, I thought I'd give it a go. I just used breeze blocks and mortar mix for this. I took this time-lapse video, but obviously I didn't tighten the knob of the tripod correctly, and that's why the camera's tipping over. At this point it was time to start working on the frame, so I marked up on the 3x2s where all of the half lap joints and cuts would need to be made. I used the table saw and a crosscut sled for this, and for the half lap joints I just made a series of cuts on the table saw just to form each joint. A dado stack would have made this much quicker, but unfortunately my table saw doesn't accept them. Once all of the cuts were made, I just used a chisel to clean up each joint. And once all of those joints were cleaned up, I used an offcut of 3x2 just to check that each joint was a good fit. Then I labelled up each piece of wood to represent which panel it belonged to, and an H or a V to represent whether that piece would be horizontal or vertical in the frame. So it's time to start assembling the panels, and my brother helps me here. We just used some wood glue and 2 decking screws through each half lap joint, and a framing square just to make sure that everything was square. The next day I decided to fit the windows in the frame. Unfortunately, with this particular panel, I had a bit of an accident. As you can probably see in the footage, it started to rain, and in my haste to cover up the panels to keep them dry, this panel fell over and the biggest pane of glass that you can see on the left smashed. Luckily, the pane of glass on the right remained intact, so I ended up cutting the window frame in half with my angle grinder, and I just have to live with having a smaller window. On the plus side though, it means I'll have more wall space inside to hang tools. I decided to use a pressure-treated wooden shiplap for the cladding. It was very wet when it was delivered, so I laid it outside in the sun for a few days to dry out. And I had to keep it indoors for a few weeks after that. I was worried that if I fitted the cladding while the moisture content was so high, that eventually in the warmer weather, when the wood dries out, the cladding would shrink across the grain and it might leave gaps in between each piece of cladding. So to be on the safe side, I found lots of ingenious places indoors to store the wood until it dried out. Next, it was time to cut the shiplap cladding to size. I got all of this shiplap cladding from a local sawmill, and it's 19mm thick, 120mm wide, and it comes in lengths of either 2.4 metres or 3.6 metres. To keep my cuts to a consistent length, I just used an offcut from the first piece that I'd cut to mark up the rest of the boards before making the next cut. As it was now November, we were getting some pretty wet weather at the weekends, so there wasn't too much I could do outside. So instead, my friend Alex made a start on installing the electrics. We had to find a way of running the twin and earth cable from the consumer unit downstairs, upstairs, and ultimately into the loft. I spent the following weekend laying the foundations for the workshop by levelling off the floor and laying some paving slabs on which to place the 2x2 treated bearers that the workshop would sit on top of, but I didn't take any footage of that, so the next footage I have is when I started to assemble the frame. I used clamps to hold the frame together temporarily. And 4.5-inch bolts with nuts and washers to join the frame together. Then I started to clad the frame with the shiplap. I used a 2mm drill bit to drill a pilot hole and drywall screws to attach the cladding. I then ripped some 2-inch strips from a couple of pieces of the cladding to use as uprights at each corner to protect the end grain of the cladding from the weather. And this is installing the corner uprights. And for this I used a 2mm drill bit to use as a pilot hole and some galvanised nails. And this is how the corners turned out.